NFL football starts today. Oh, people like that. Nice. Like a month or so ago, I was sitting in the office and my phone, like this buzz came up that $10 was charged to my American Express card. And I was like, oh, that's weird. I just thought of some random thing. And then like 5 minutes later, another $10. And I was like, that's odd. And then I just forgot about it. It's kind of normal. Apple Pay reminds you, shows you if you have expenses on there. And then I opened up my email like an hour later and there was like five or six charges of $10 a piece from Microsoft. So I was like, $60 later, and I'm like, did I not update a subscription? What is going on? And I just let it go, and then like the next day it happened again, and I literally was like, what is going on? And I realized that my son was buying V-Bucks on Fortnite. $10 a pop, $1,000, and he was like buying all this stuff from the virtual store and filling up his locker with skins and boots and hats and gloves, and I was like, I literally almost had a conniption fit. Because like Carmen said, the game is free to download, and I had this moment where my head almost exploded because I thought that there was a conspiracy against parents that was set up by these Fortnite, EA, whatever company that set it up so that you have to buy stuff in order to win. And I thought, this is outrageous! They're making you pay to win? That's genius and evil. This is a diabolical plot against parents. So your kid on Fortnite has this little headset on. They join the Battle Royale. There's 100 of them. They all fight, like you saw in the bumper, until there's the last man standing. And ultimately, they get bought in because they're in this community with all their friends, talking to all the kids in the neighborhood, and they just absolutely want to win. And so emotionally they get bought in, and then it's like, wait a minute, you mean that in order for them to win, I have to spend more money than my neighbor? That's what I thought it was. My neighbor John's right here. I was like, he's got to spend more money. Me and John are going to be seeing who wants to spend more money on Fortnite. I'm like, I can't win. He's a dentist. I have to pull back at some point here. Like, so then literally I didn't know like what was going on. And so I was like, this cannot be true. So I called Kevin, because of course Kevin knows all things, you know, technology. I'm a duck hunt guy. And like, I call him and I'm like, dude, do you have to like buy V-Bucks in order to win? And he's like, no. And I'm like, well, what's the point? He's like, dude, V-Bucks are just literally these virtual dollars. They mean something else, victory dollars, the dollars that you have in order to buy stuff just to make the game better. In fact, V-Bucks, they don't help you win. You don't even need to buy anything, but it makes the game way better if you do. So what they've done is they've given everyone this game, and instead of people having to go around and gaining things you need, like in Zelda or Metroid, or for any of you that grew up in the 90s, like in these games, yeah, where you like have to like get stuff in order to win, this, you don't have to, you have to go around and get stuff and fight well, but the stuff that you buy, you do not need it to win. So what they're doing is they're playing on kids' desires to just dress up fake characters and like buy dances. Like literally it is absolutely genius. And because they're playing on kids' wants, they're making more money than any game in the history of the world. $1 billion by now spent on V-Bucks. That is crazy. That literally made me step back and go, wow, I think that what this game does is it unpacks and it kind of presses the nerve of a much bigger issue. And again, my son plays Fortnite. You know, we have to limit his time and all that stuff. But so I'm not, you know, throwing the baby out with the bathwater and saying Fortnite is all bad. You have to limit that, and it's fine for him to have a little bit of it, but like we have to pull back. But the thing that it does is it makes kids and it's making people think about what they want and not what they need. And ultimately in life, and I see this right now, that because survival, our basic needs are met, that most of us now are kind of living in this world of wants as opposed to taking care of our basic needs. And so we're not thinking about our needs, we're not understanding our needs. Now, if you grew up in the 90s, you remember that there was a beautiful game that showed up at your elementary school that did the exact opposite of Fortnite, a beautiful game called the Oregon Trail. Anybody remember this? Now this is a game that teaches you, you better get what you need or you'll die. Not get what you want and look good. You better get enough food. You better hunt enough. You better get enough supplies. You better travel at the right time. You better learn to fish, hunt, whatever it is. Otherwise, you're gonna die. And what I think is this whole idea, this gaming reality that we're experiencing right now, and just in the world in general, it is starting to press the nerve of this wants versus needs, because ultimately, I believe that we think we need less. We think we need less, but we're suffering more than ever. We think we need less, but there's still travesties happening. There's still crisis coming and people showing up broken and going, I didn't realize I needed that. I didn't realize I had a need. I read in an article this morning in NBC News that this child, this 13-year-old, took his life in Montana. And in the state of Montana, it's the highest suicide rate in all of the nation. And it's because the people aren't very close to one another. There's less people per, you know, square mile. And of course, they have all their needs met. But because of government things, they've removed some of the people in that world that can help with mental health. And because people aren't connected relationally, they're losing that relationship dynamic and they're losing that connectivity that they need as humans. And so the suicide rate is going up. So people have more. We have Wi-Fi. We have food if we need it. We have shelter if we need it. But we're not thinking about our needs. We're just thinking about our wants. We're thinking about everything else. And so I believe in the heart of this series is I speak with people all the time who show up. They either show up in my office or I hear about them or I sit and talk with them. And they basically get to this point in their life of crisis. And crisis, my friends, comes to the people who are prepared and to the people who are unprepared. It's an equal opportunity offender. It's just like the Oregon Trail. You see, you're going to take off on your life, and you may go across the frontier for a little while, but eventually you're going to hit tough weather. Eventually, those first pioneers that went out on the frontier in this great country, they hit the Rocky Mountains. And the first ones that got there and didn't have their wagon packed with what they needed to make it over, they didn't survive. And I sit with people all the time who are showing up in the midst of crisis, and they're going, I don't know how I got here. I don't have what I need. I don't have what I need relationally. I don't have what I need financially. I don't have what I need physically in my life. I don't have what I need mentally. I didn't know. And really what it is it's a pride that went awry, that went bad. Because at some point earlier, maybe someone told them that they needed something, but they said, ah. I know for sure when I'll sit with married couples and I get their 40-page printout of kind of their relationship dynamics, that I'll sit with them and go, hey, you know, you have some needs here. You have some differences spiritually. You have some differences confrontationally. You see it this way. They see it that way. And because the wedding is planned, they go, eh, we don't need that. And then they show up 15 years later. They show up 19 years later. They show up 25 years later and they go, we lost something. We didn't realize that we needed this, so now we're in crisis. I meet with people that started their own businesses, and they just threw caution to the wind, and they just vested and borrowed and all this stuff, and people were going, warning sign, you should wait, don't borrow that much money, get some advice, get some counsel, we don't need that. Then recession, then financial fallout, then there they are, they're broken. We didn't know we needed 6 months in the bank. Or actually, we did know we needed 6 months in the bank. We just didn't do it. So now when crisis came, we don't have what we need. I know people that have been told, you know, you got some blood pressure things. You got some health problems, some things you got to watch for. You got to eat different. You got to do this. And they just go through life. And then they show up in my office. And they're broken. And almost sometimes beyond the point of no return. Because they didn't take care of themselves. And so what I believe, just like the Oregon Trail, is that every one of us has desperate, desperate needs in life. And that when you hear those needs, and you listen and you actually let those needs drive your decisions for whatever path, whatever trail you're going to go down, that humility, that recognition of weakness is the beginning of victory. It's kind of my bottom line for today is understanding we're needy is the first step towards victory. Understanding that you have great needs is the first step toward you actually overcoming any crisis, overcoming any obstacle, is starting off understanding I have some, but I'm not full, and I could grow. I have lots to learn. I have lots to understand. And some of you are just listening to this ethereally, but you are actually in a moment in your life where you are staring something in the face that if you were honest, it was saying, you don't have this figured out. You don't know the answer. You're in trouble, and you are avoiding it. You are acting like you have it all together. You don't want to admit your weaknesses. You don't want to say, I'm struggling. You don't want to be vulnerable. You don't want to expose your weaknesses. And sometimes we have reasons for that. We've done that before and we've lost trust. But ultimately, so many of us are in here. And instead of admitting weaknesses, even in safe places, we lack a level of humility. And we walk through life with pride. And so it's another way to say it is this understanding we're needy is the beginning of humility. It's the beginning of humility. There's lots of different definitions for humility. That's what I'm going to talk about in this section of Battle Royale is this idea of neediness and how neediness and understanding our depravity and understanding our weaknesses is the beginning of victory in our lives so that we can fill up and we can conquer and we can win and we can experience life in the Battle Royale. The idea of humility is this idea of an appropriate view of self, and there's been a lot of studies done. Psychology Today did a study on what humility is, and they defined it. I want to use it and point out some things about what I'm talking about. True humility, scientists have learned, is when someone has an accurate assessment of both his strengths and his, say it, an accurate assessment of strengths and weaknesses. You see, humility says, I know my strengths and I know my weaknesses. I know that I have a need in these areas. You see, some of us are sitting in the room and you're going, all I hear is weakness. All I feel is weakness. And you're struggling because you might lack that confidence. And that's because you have some voice in your life that's a lie. Because the truth will bring you to an honest, safe place of humility. Every person is made in the image of God. Every person is beautiful. Every person has skills and talents and something wonderful to offer the world. The lies are that you don't have those things and that what you have to offer doesn't really matter. That's a lie. Everyone is beautiful. Everyone is brilliant in their own way. Everyone is made in the image of God, and everyone has strengths and everyone has weaknesses. And God put us in this whole thing together so that we could lock arms and help each other through and be vulnerable and care for one another. But we don't do that. This is humility, understanding your weakness. And he sees all this in the context of the larger whole. He's a part of something far greater than he. He knows he isn't the center of the universe. And he's both grounded and liberated by this knowledge. Recognizing his abilities, he asks how he can contribute. And then look at this. Recognizing his flaws, he asks how he can grow. Today, what I want everyone to ask is this question. How can I grow? What are my needs? What are my needs? Because I don't want you to show up at the Rocky Mountains. I don't want you to show up unprepared. You see, I have met people who have this stability, they have this fulfillment, they've been humble, they've recognized needs, they've sought out answers, it's called wisdom. They come to chaos and crisis and they withstand it. I have met some people that have gone through the greatest crises you could possibly fathom. The loss of a family member, the loss of a spouse, the loss of a business, the loss of their own health. And I have seen people that have a humility that they understand that they were broken and they don't show up broken to those moments because along the way they learned and they were filled with the right things. And I've seen people that do the opposite. You see, here's another thought for humility. On the intrapersonal level, humility involves an accurate view of the self. An accurate view, strengths and weaknesses. I know me. I know what I'm good at. I know what I'm not good at. I know how I'm capable. I know what I'm not capable of. I know what I'm afraid of. I know what I have confidence for. I know me. I know what I'm able to bring to the world. I know when I have to step back and let someone else bring it. On the interpersonal, that's the idea of what goes on in your head. You have an accurate view. On the other side, on the interpersonal, as we relate to one another, not just to ourselves, humility involves a stance that is others-oriented rather than self-focused. Now, you may think, you know, Joel, what in the world am I going to do if I admit all my weaknesses? I mean, most of us, we live in a world that says, don't be vulnerable, don't be weak. If you show your weaknesses, someone's going to take advantage of that and expose you. Someone's going to make you feel like you made a mistake. And oftentimes, there are places, and you have to be very, very careful where you go on this journey of discovering your weaknesses, because some people are out to get you. They're out to show you what you're bad at or show you what you're not. But in a place like the local church and in a place with trusted friends, you have to go on this journey, because actually what science says is that humility, understanding your needs, truly understanding that you are not better than others, that you should look up to others, and that there's something in you that is great, but there is also something in you that's missing. That you always have something missing, that you always have something to grow on. Science has proven that there are overall benefits for humility. Look at this. This is from Psychology Today, the actual benefits of humility that have been proven. Interestingly, the empirical research on humility shows that this trait has great value. Humility has been linked with better academic performance. Right? I mean, when you think you know everything, and some of you go, well, I do know everything. And there's very few people that know everything. But even the best people that are the sharpest, they still study all the time. They get better. They learn. And their performance subjectively goes higher. People that think they know everything are the ones that fail the test. The ones that go in and go, I got to grow. I got to learn. I got to study. I got to memorize. These are the ones that increase academic job performance. When you recognize and you show up to a job and you recognize that you might be missing something and you keep your mouth quiet because you might not know. It's that proverb, you know, I've talked about it before. It's better to keep yourself quiet and have everybody think you're a fool than to open your mouth and remove all doubt. You see, when you know that you're missing something, that you might not understand the conversation, that you have to learn more, what happens is because you expose that void, you learn more. You get it. You start to figure it out. If you think you've got it figured out, you're basically saying that your half cup is capped off. But if you take off the top and you go, I got a lot to learn, and you walk around going, will you show me? Will you teach me? I don't know. You know. I want to know. I'm hungry for knowledge. I'm hungry to understand. What happens is that void eventually gets full, and then you start to perform better. The benefits are incredible, and excellence in leadership. I mean, we have a culture that says, act like you got it all together, tell people what to do, but excellence in leadership has actually been defined by many people who are much more skilled and much greater experts than me in leadership, have actually defined the greatest leadership qualities around the idea of humility, around the idea of seeing people, the upside down pyramid, you exist to serve them, you exist to help them, you exist to understand what they're going through, and in that, you become a better leader, all because you understand you have needs. Humble people have a better social relationships. I mean, have you ever met someone who you don't see very often, but the whole time you talk to them, all they do is talk about themselves, all they do is talk about what they have together, all they do is just talk about what's good and going on with them. They never ask you. They just want you to know that they have it all together. If that's you, there's a reason people don't talk to you very much. Because it's annoying to talk to someone who constantly acts like they have it all together. Because we all know no one does. And so when someone is putting on, it destroys relationships. When someone comes to a relationship and interaction with humility, honesty, it is totally fine to show up to someone you haven't talked to in a while and go, I'm doing great. I'm doing fine. I've had good days and bad days. And if you're having good days, you don't need to lie about it with false humility. People pick up on that. But if you're struggling, you know what is going to make you have better friends? Admit that you're struggling. What's going to make you more desirable for the people around you? Admit that you're going through something. Tell them. This is what happens when we actually understand we have a need. When we expose our need, it actually draws people close to us. Projected strength pushes people away. Avoid deception in their social interactions, and they tend to be forgiving. You see, when you're humble and you know you have needs, all it does is start to show you, it gives you a reflection of everyone else in the world. I have needs. I'm broken. So do they. They have needs. They have problems. They have issues. They're going through something. And if they do something to me, who am I not to forgive them? Prideful people think I got it all together, and as soon as you attack my little nest, then I'm never going to let you go. But humble people, people who recognize their need, forgive. People who are humble are grateful. They understand that they have deficiencies, and so what that means is when those deficiencies get full, they're grateful, they're thankful. You don't walk around a bunch of people that have everything together, they look like they're together. You don't walk around a bunch of those people and see them living grateful, thankful lives. They actually think, thank God for me, I filled my life up. And they don't see the reality that they are half full like everybody else. So they don't live in gratitude. And they are cooperative. I mean, basically, when you look at the science behind humility, when someone is humble, it actually makes them into the likable people on earth. The people that we all like. They're forgiving. They're grateful. They're easy to get along with. They're kind. They care. They're vulnerable. They're real. Humility. And when I see in the heart, literally, the way that I write these series is like I have this like inexpressed, inherent burden, right? I'm intuitive and I feel it. And here's what I feel. I feel people all the time showing up to me in a moment of crisis. And the reason that they're in that crisis is because they lacked the insight of need earlier in their life. They didn't have it. They didn't go, oh, I need relationship help. Oh, I need financial help. Oh, I need some emotional, internal, mental health. I need help. And so what happens is they put it off. They show up later, and that weakness is exposed and causing destruction. And actually what happens when you admit your needs is your entire life starts to elevate so that you can be filled. A recent set of studies also shows that humility is a consistent predictor of generosity. Isn't that amazing? You think, man, when I'm full, then I'll give out. But really what it shows you is that when we realize that we have needs and we realize other people have needs, that we start to become generous. Man, oh, because they have needs and I have needs and we need to be generous and we need to help one another. And what would the world be like if we just actually started to fill each other's buckets up? And they become generous. You see, I believe with all my heart, understanding we're needy is the first step towards victory. What battle do you want to win? What road do you want to go down? Do you want to be successful in a business? Do you want to be successful in a marriage? Do you want to be successful in your health? Do you want to be successful at your job? You have to know you have needs. When you know you have needs, your life will flip upside down and you will start down the pathway to success. Knowing you have needs is something that God talked about all the time. In fact, what we have to understand is that in this conversation about needs, the greatest need that we all have is a need for God. The message of Jesus, the message of the gospel, is a message of need. It's a message of need. Jesus didn't send us out into the world to tell the world that they're all pretty good people. He sent us out in the world to help us see the need. We're broken. People are broken. They're hurting. They're suffering. And the kingdom of God, the message of God, the people of God, they bring a solution to that neediness. Jesus didn't show up to our full cups and say, I'm going to give you a little bit more. He showed up and he said, you have an empty cup. And if you accept me, I will fill you up. And in fact, I will fill you up and make you overflow with the gift of God. And so the beginning of actual change is our recognition of our greatest need. You see, you're not going to recognize your other needs until you recognize your greatest need. And when you recognize your greatest need, you'll understand that that idea of need applies everywhere else in your life. And you will live your life going, oh, I need this. Oh, I need that. Oh, I'm broken. Oh, I need this. I got to grow. I need God more than anything is the motto of the humble. What Jesus does is something amazing in Matthew chapter 5. In Matthew chapter 5, he showed up. He started to tell everyone that he is bringing and ushering in the kingdom of heaven. In Matthew chapter 4, he says, the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Repent, which means turn away from the kingdom of Rome and turn away from the religious leaders of Israel who are away from God, moving away from God, and repent from that and make national change under my kingdom. Follow me. Follow my life. Follow my way. Repent from the way things go normally on the earth, and I will lead you towards life. And so what he does is he calls some disciples and says, come follow me. We're going to be the ones that start the kingdom of God. We're going to give the message of God. We're going to give the method of God. We're going to give the love of God. We're going to tell everybody what this is all about. We're going to show them first. So then he goes into a city and he starts healing people. So this is actually, in the story of Christianity, this is what got the most attention in the first 100 years. Miracles. Not very many people saw the miracles, but a lot of people heard about them. And not very many people talked about miracles because they didn't happen that much. But when they were talked about, it gained traction. It's actually one of the hallmarks of how the early church started. Miracles. So Jesus goes in, he heals people. There's some people that are blind, they get healed. There's some people that are sick, they're not sick anymore. There's some people that are deaf, they can hear. He starts healing people. The disciples see this, and the people in that area go, oh, this guy is doing stuff that's different. He's bringing a different kind of life. We want to know more. We want to know more. If he can heal people, I mean, this is a place that, you know, at Earth, this time on planet Earth, people were constantly dying of famine, of sickness. It was constant. So when you know that there's a guy who can heal, you're interested just for the pragmatic reasons. So Jesus said, I'm bringing in a new kingdom. Oh, anything but the kingdom of Rome, this tyrannical rampage of humanity that says might makes right and lives with a sword. Please bring us something different. This guy has power now. Okay, what's it all about? So Jesus shows up to this mountainside, and all the people have heard he's done miracles, and all the people say he's bringing in a new kingdom. What is your kingdom all about? They want to know, what's your kingdom all about? Where are you taking us? What's this going to be about? What does it mean to live life on earth according to you? What is the kingdom like? What is earth like? What should our relationship with God look like? And you would imagine that if this guy who's saying he's a king that's ushering all these people into a new kingdom, that if he stood up and said, here's what my kingdom is about, just start to think about what you could imagine he would say. My kingdom is about doing the right thing, giving your life away, or saying the right things, or acting right all the time. You start to go into it, and here's what he says. He actually says something that should blow your mind when you think about what he's saying is coming, a different kingdom, a different life, a different way of living. He says this, and it ties right into Battle Royale. He says this to open up. The first verse he says in his kingdom talk about what the kingdom of God is about is this: blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are people that recognize they have spiritual needs. In this, he goes, if you realize that you need me, you will be filled with me. If you realize that spiritually you are broken, I will fix you. If you realize that spiritually you are dead, I will fill you up. If you recognize your spiritual needs, I'm here to fill it up. But people that don't recognize their needs won't be filled. You won't get God if you don't think you need God. If you don't humble yourself and recognize your needs, then what is God for you? You got it all figured out. In fact, the Bible would say you're a God of your own. You've made yourself a God. You just supply all your needs and you don't have anything. And then the Bible would also say that that's the beginning of destruction. Blessed, happy, victorious are the people who recognize above anything else for life on earth that they have a spiritual need. I mean, do you spend every day thinking about your spiritual need? That's the beginning of humility, my friends. You wake up every morning, you go, oh, I'm tired. Oh, I feel dirty, I need a shower. Oh, I gotta get that email. Oh, I gotta finish that conversation. Oh, I gotta fix that relationship. I got lots of needs. I gotta eat, I gotta talk, I gotta go, I gotta be important. I have all these needs. Jesus says the most important need you could ever have is spiritual. And when you recognize that you have a spiritual need, you'll wake up every day and say, God, my cup is empty. I need you. And he says, that's what I'm here for. I'm here to help those who recognize their need. Look what he goes on. He says, blessed are those who mourn. Come on, your kingdom sounds like a bunch of crying people. No. His kingdom is for those people that understand they need his kingdom. When you recognize you need his kingdom, you look at your life, and mourning means you understand your need. It means you cry. You go, oh, I'm so broken. I need God today, and I get on my knees. Can I tell you what? If you've never been on your knees, you might not really understand your spiritual need. Like if you've never just woken up in the morning, you want to try something crazy? For 2 minutes this week, when you're all alone, just get on your knees before God and just say, I need you. Get low and see him fill you up. Start to recognize your need. Mourn about it. Cry about it. God, I need you. And see what the rest of your day is like. Blessed are the meek, those that have power, but they control it, and they're going to inherit the earth. Totally opposite. We think might, right, power, win, fight, pride, strength. Blessed are those who are meek, who actually have some restraint on themselves. And then you look at what he ends with. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for you will be filled. You will be filled when you know you need to be filled. You will get your needs met when you recognize them. Understanding that we're needy is the beginning of victory. When pride comes, when we don't think we need it, that is where disgrace happens, and that is when we lose sight of life, and that is when the crisis comes and exposes all that lack of growth that we could have had. And so it is your job to pursue humility. To pursue an accurate view of you, to pursue an accurate view of your strengths and your weaknesses. And I'll tell you this, if you don't intentionally move towards humility, to identify your weaknesses, to outline your needs, to surround your life and build your life around the fact that you have needs and that you are weak, you will certainly be prideful. You will certainly live a life of self-sustaining motion. You will believe that you are all you need until you recognize that you're not and you move towards humility. You see, the brother of Jesus says this in James chapter 4. He says this whole thing about how God gives grace to the humble but opposes the proud. It's a beautiful idea. You see, we're actually, if we knew accurately, we have great needs. And when we go to God and we say, God, I'm half full on this area of my life, my relationship, my emotional stability, whatever it is, then he fills that up. Think about it. A half full vessel doesn't deserve more. It deserves nothing, right? It's broken. Here's my brokenness. And he gives grace, getting what you don't deserve. So when you come to him, you get overfilled. He says if you come to him, he will fill you up. It says he gives grace to those that recognize they're empty, but opposes those who think they're full. What that means is that life doesn't work for those who don't recognize they're needy. It doesn't work. You're going to be opposed financially. You're going to be opposed relationally. You're going to be opposed emotionally because you have these needs. You don't think you do, so you're the emperor that has no clothes. Everything is fine. No, it's not. And that's the way you're going to live life. And what it's going to feel like is the sovereign, mighty hand of God pushing against your every move. And what it really is you walking through life with a hand tied behind your back and one leg. Because you didn't recognize you had one leg. You didn't recognize you had one hand. You didn't recognize your need. God wants to fulfill you. give you legs to run, give you hands to serve, give you a place to go. And James ends this section in James chapter 4. He says, humble yourself before the Lord and he will lift you up. So I want to end today with talking about humbling yourself. Because if I was going to brag about one thing, I would have to brag about how humble I am. I have learned the art of humility. No, I'm sorry. The reason that I am able to speak about humbling yourself is I'm the kind of personality that people think I'm arrogant because they're right. No, I am the kind of personality that as soon as people meet me, I have a confidence that even as a young man, 17 years old, 15 years old, 22 years old, people just assume that I had too much confidence. And even if I was just confident or extroverted or whatever it was, and I wasn't actually overly confident in the moment, I heard all the time that the perception of me was that I'm arrogant. And so what that did is it made me move in and ask the question, am I arrogant? And here's what I found. Yes. But maybe not in the areas, not just because I'm outgoing. You think that's arrogance because I have a boisterous personality because I want to get up on. That's not arrogance. Arrogance is way worse than that. Arrogance is something where you don't have an accurate view of yourself. Maybe you have some brokenness. You have some blindedness to who you are, what motivates you. And so what that all did for me was send me on a little bit of a fast track to doing this, magnifying my needs. And that's what humbling yourself is magnifying your needs. And so there's a couple ways to magnify your needs, and it's really hard work. It's really humbling. And I suggest you do it because I believe with all of my heart that the beginning of the victorious life is a life that says, I have great needs. I have great needs. I've recognized those needs and I need God to fill those things spiritually, and then I need to take every area of my life and apply the same truth. And here's the first one I think that you need to do in order to magnify your needs, to humble yourself, and it's this: become self-aware. Go on a journey of self-awareness. This is really hard to do. And the thing that makes it so hard is the tests that you read. When you start to take these self-awareness tests, they show you the good and the bad. So when I was in college, it was the first time I had this experience of taking the four personality type test: sanguine, choleric, phlegmatic, melancholy. And I found that I'm a sanguine. Any sanguines in the room, have you ever heard of this? No, just me. Sanguine is someone who I read about, and I went, oh, this is great. And what it says about them is that they're great at starting. But then if you read on, it says they're bad finishers. And I read that and I went, I remember in college reading that and going, that ain't me. That's not me. That's not me. And then I got my first job. And I started strong. And I quit within a year. And I went back one time and I looked at that test and it said sanguines are great at starting but bad at finishing. And I went, it's true. It's true. And that's hard to learn. And so then what I did is I went on the next job and I said, you know, I'm going to stay here. I'm going to fight through. I'm going to finish strong. And honestly, I didn't do well until the third job. It was really hard for me because it's part of my personality. But by the time I got to the end of my third job, I showed up in a healthy way. It was a great thing. Anybody taking the Enneagram? I'm just showing you how I learned my needs. You have to learn your needs. You're a bad finisher. If you're a bad finisher, you have to learn how to finish well and adjust to that reality. Enneagram. Okay, go take the Enneagram test. We're having our people in 514 lead go through this. I'm a 7. Which is the enthusiast. And here's the hard thing about learning your needs. Here's what it starts out in the definition. 7s are extroverted, absolutely optimistic, that's true, versatile, and spontaneous. How fun, playful, high-spirited, and practical. Man, I like to be me. It sounds good to be me. And if you're silly, you stop here, because if you read on, all the yellow is danger. Look what it says. They can also misapply their many talents. I disagree. Becoming overextended. Scattered. Not at all. And undisciplined. Now we're getting somewhere. You understand how hard this is? To look at something and it says to you, Joel, you lack discipline. That's a need. That's a humility. That means if I don't start to work discipline into my life, at some point the lack of discipline will cause a major crisis in my life. They constantly seek new and exciting experiences, but can become distracted and exhausted by staying on the go. They typically have problems with impatience and impulsiveness. My father-in-law's in here. Dan, isn't that true? Maybe he left. Impatience. Oh my gosh, I always sugarcoated my impatience with just a zeal for life. No, we gotta go. We gotta keep going. The thing about patience is you don't know that you're impatient until you don't want to be patient anymore. And so I learned, oh, I am definitely impatient. I want to move way too fast. And knowing that that's a need, I started to adjust that. Here's the one that is the hardest. To actually learn what your needs are or what some of your weaknesses are. And I'm going to give you this. This is a question that comes from a book called The Ideal Team Player. And if you really want to cause a nice, spirited conversation in your marriage or at work, ask this question. But what will happen is if you ask this question and you're genuine and you sit back and listen, the answer to this question will start to give you a level of self-awareness that shows you where you're weak, where you have needs, where you're broken. It's this question. It says this: what's it like to be on the other side of me? You want to have like a crazy conversation with your spouse? Just go, you know what? I'm going to give you the floor. Go ahead and just for 4 minutes, talk about what it's like to be on the other side of me. And then just zip your lips and you will write down a bunch of things that define your needs. And if you can actually take that and just because of what's been revealed, you're on the pathway to success. You see, this question, even asking it, is a humble question. Okay, there's got to be things that are about me that I don't understand, that are negative, that are difficult, and I want to get better, so go ahead, tell me what they are. Have this discussion in the car ride on the way home. I can't wait to hear about it. Here's the second one. Self-aware, self-care. Self-care. You want to start to identify your needs and become humble. Ask the question, what do I need? Doesn't that sound silly? So simple. Start asking the question, what do I need? How do I take care of myself? Because when you start to ask, what do I need, and you stop asking, what do they need, and what do I need to do to make sure that I look like I have it all together and I got to keep going every single day, you start to define your weaknesses. I mean, there's some moms in the room right now that just need to be told, like, you need to take care of yourself. You need 6 hours of sleep. You need it straight. You need a lot of sleep. You need time. It's okay to take care of yourself. And that will bring you to that level of humility. When you start to self-care, you go, I need these things. It's okay to admit that you need time alone with your friends. It's okay to admit that you need time to sleep. It's okay to admit that you need whatever, time to go out with friends and have a good time. It's okay to go, this is what fills my bucket. This is what I need. And when you start to do that, you start to see where you have these disparities. And you start to move towards filling them up. And the third one we talked about earlier today is serve. In Serve CBUS, we got this opportunity to move into the world, into places that are desperate, that are in great need. And there's something beautiful about helping people with their needs, is it shows us how wonderfully beautiful it is to just be a part of the human race, to just be a part of other people that are just like you. They live somewhere else. They're struggling the same way that you would and could, but you somehow have the opportunity to serve them, and that is humbling. And that shows us we all have needs. We all need to eat. I did Meals on Wheels. I was spending time with people that are just like everybody else. They just happen to have a bad, you know, situation happen in their life, and they need help, and here we are to help them, and thank goodness we're there to help them because they're just like us. They need food, and so do I. They need someone to hug them and listen to them, and so do I. And so when we help people with their needs, we're reminded of how we're all so needy. And understanding we're needy is the first step towards victory. So let me just pray for all of us as we just go to God, and don't bring pretense to God. Be honest with God. God sees you as you really are, and he sees you as a vessel that is wonderfully beautiful and created in his image, but is so needy. And when you recognize that need, he's there to fill it up. And that's the way the rest of the world works. So could you just go to God and just rid yourself of pride? You don't have it together. You don't have everything figured out. You're not totally full, and neither am I, and we all need God. So let's just go to him and just say, God, we need you. Let's just pray for a second. Father, we are so incredibly needy. We need you in every moment. We need you every hour. We need you to breathe life into us. We need you to sustain us. And God, we are sinful, broken individuals who have minds that run astray to thoughts that are evil, who have hearts that move in directions that are far from you. We are evil people that are broken, that need you. And Father, we all have so many needs. We have relationship needs. We have financial needs. We have work needs. God, some of us just have personal needs. We just need rest. And God, we just come before you today and just admit, just confess, we're broken. We need you. And you tell us, God, that a broken spirit and a contrite heart you will not despise, but that you will fill, that you will help. God, fill us up. Fill us up with your spirit. Help us to have a humble attitude about every area. Help us to never think that we have it all figured out. Help us to never feel that we have everything managed. And help us to constantly live from this place of humility, of need, and understanding. Help us to ask more questions. Help us to think longer and speak less. Help us to slow down our hearts. Help us to be patient. Help us to love and serve those around us. God, help us to take care of ourselves. Help us to gain new insights into who we are so we can recognize our needs and they can be filled. We love you. We worship you. In Jesus' name, amen. Over the next